So, Aaron, go ahead and introduce who you are and your work here at the school and how you want to begin to introduce flexible grouping in your classroom.
So my name is Aaron Shaken. I'm a first-year math teacher, first-year teacher in general. I switched careers at my Gaithersburg High School. I teach 2-year Algebra 2 and on-level Algebra 2, and I'm working to learn to integrate flexible grouping in my classes. That's something I've heard a lot about from my PLC members, who have been very helpful in all aspects of helping me plan and prepare and learn how to work in my classes. But more recently, we've discussed flexible grouping, so that students have the opportunity to work with different kids on different days and share ideas. And I think as far as for me implementing it, I'm only a few weeks in, but I'm hoping to observe a lot of my other teachers, both ones in my PLC and ones in the department in general, that have experience with this and have done various methods of flexible grouping. Just today, I'm going to be observing a teacher and seeing how they implement it as far as classroom management goes, as far as how they facilitate the class, and then also invite them to come give me feedback when I begin to implement these things in my classroom, as I hope to in the coming days and weeks. So that's definitely something I look to do going forward, because I think group work is a very integral part of what we do in math class. I think students have a great resource to learn from each other, and I think it's really inhibits them if you're just only allowing them to learn from the few people they're sitting around, and if they're not moving seats or working with other people in class.
So, how has your PLC kind of helped you in terms of the planning side of it?
So they've given me quite a number of ideas. We've just been discussing ways to group people based on different ability level, how comfortable they feel with the material, or whether it's just random grouping, or counting off, or just shifting the groups or shifting the seats on a regular basis, to so that students are working with other individuals in the class that they don't work with the same people on a daily basis. If you have, I mean, after we spoke about like using tribes and grouping students into tribal groupings that you would post, I guess, at the beginning of the day. You could either switch that up on a regular basis, or have tribes that they know they go to when they go, go to your tribes or go to your groups. That's an option. Another thing I've seen and heard of in the past is like clock buddies, where you have 12 different like appointments, and I say you go to your 2 o'clock partner, and they would all go to meet the person they have on the 2 o'clock, and it gives them like 12 different options. So if you're cycling through them on different days, it gives students a chance to work with, I guess, 12 different other individuals in the room, and then you can even switch it up throughout the year, so they can ultimately have a chance to work with the whole class. So those are just a few of the ways that I've heard and seen other teachers do it, and I look forward to observing them.
Thank you. So, how is it that you make decisions about how to group kids? What are the different kinds of structures that you use in grouping students?
So I typically like to have my students in groups of four. Regular everyday class period, I always have them in groups of four. I typically like to have either totally the same gender groups or two and two if possible, because sometimes students, when it's three and one, will get feel like they're outnumbered by the other gender and maybe not feel as comfortable, and I've seen it go both ways with that, with boys and girls. So I typically like groups of four, and then that's for every day. And then I've also done a lot of different grouping strategies for practice activities throughout class. The key to these is the more you do them, the more you group with other people that they're not used to sitting next to, the better. And I also change seats very often, so they're constantly being moved around and sitting with new people all the time. One of the ways I group is I will give students a topic that we've previously covered, and I will say, okay, how do you feel about this topic on a stoplight? Are you agreeing? Do you fully get it? Totally understand? Are you a yellow? You're somewhere in the middle. You're kind of getting it, kind of not getting it. or you are red, you have no idea, you're totally not understanding it. And then I will pair a green with a yellow to work on a worksheet or to work on a practice activity. And then I will take all the reds in a group and work more closely with those red students. Another thing I do is I have something called Survivor Algebra, where I will have the students have that are totally separate from their regular seats. They have tribes. The tribes change every quarter. And the tribes are made up of 4 students, 1 high, 2 middle, 1 low. And they compete on assessments with other tribes. And then they get prizes if they win and things like that. And so that's, we typically will do tribe work for review activities. And so that's another way that we group kids. And the more often you have them work in tribes, the more they get comfortable with it and are able to talk with their tribe mates.
Thank you. Can you talk a little bit about how you decide what kinds of tasks to give students? Like how often do you work in groups? Is this a daily thing?
I do try to have some conversation, some discourse every single day, whether it be with the students in their regular pairs or groups of 4, or whether it be something where we move around. I do think every day or almost every day is the key to the students getting comfortable with group work. Most of the time, my group work can just be practice of what we did in the notes that day, but occasionally it's other more interesting activities, problem-based activities. But it depends on time and it depends on, you know, what the topic is.
How do you set expectations for students as they begin their group work?
So I always, even when they're getting pretty good at it, I always try to model how I want them to talk to each other. I think it's super important to make sure that they understand how they need to be speaking. So I think this, I agree because, or I disagree because, I think it's this, I think there's a mistake here, this is what I think it is. I see what you're saying, I don't see what you're saying. These kinds of things to make sure that they're talking to each other, using, you know, not just, oh, here's what I did, okay, let me copy it down, that's not productive. So I always try to model, when we're doing group work of more than, let's say, 5 minutes, I always try to model how they should be talking to each other. And a lot of times I'll tell them who should talk first, so it gives them a starting point. So I guess that's it.
Okay. Thank you. So tell us a little bit about how you decide how to group your students, the different ways that you do that, and why you choose to do it.
I started the very first day. Like, my desks are in groups of 4. So when a student comes in, he knows or she knows where to sit. Like, first day, sit assignment, yes, but it's not permanent. I'm like, good morning, appreciate you coming on time, and all that. Then I give the interest survey. It has everything, like, where do you prefer to sit? Where, who do you want to sit with? Why do you want to sit in front, if you want to sit in front? How do you learn best? The following day, there's another group assignment based on where they prefer to sit. The first day, the reason why I assign seats is like, I want to set the tone that there is going to be a system in classroom where we want to be organized so we can finish a lot in class, accomplish our goals and all that. I usually have, the general grouping I usually do is like, I would say random group, but for them it's a random grouping, but like, for example, after every formative assessment, I group them in such a way they get the support they need without them telling you're struggling, you're the expert, no. Because I have to set up the first 2 weeks of school, I have to set up, like, this is what I use to, like, numbered heads. So on a Monday, you will be our, if you're sitting at number 1, you'll be our facilitator, encourager for the group. What does that mean? Say if there's a task for the group, I would like you to encourage somebody who, like, I cannot do this. Come on, we can do this. If he's off, like, come on, let's do this. Because there's also a timekeeper. So I assign roles per group. And Tuesday, number 2, Wednesday, number 3, Thursday, 4. On a Friday, they can select, or I can select, depending on the situation. So they get free seating, too, after, say, hey, guys, you did great informative assessment, so you get to sit where you want to sit today. And I expect you to be at your best wherever you sit. It's also like setting high expectations to every student, at the same time telling them, like, it's okay to ask questions. It's not a sign of weakness. We got to work together, because if we have only, like, 50 minutes, 47 minutes in the class, and I wouldn't be able to get to you, you should be able to work as a team. We have a goal. We got to move forward. You got to help me. Like, this is a teamwork. It's all right to make mistakes. I make mistakes, too. It's like the human side of you telling them, see, when I rush, I make mistakes. So what do I need to do? I need to take time to process. Let me see. Modeling to them. Like, if I'm the facilitator, how will I start the discussion? Then we have this sentence starters here, and if you model it to them, say, I notice that. I agree. And I tell them you can disagree without being disagreeable. And I have here the first week also setting up, instead of equity sticks, I made them do like a name tent, like this is my name, something about me that I want my teacher to know, and then this is optional. Do you want to share where you're originally from? Because by the time I do the around the world, like the stations that they call, I call it around the world activity, where I call it the destination. I use the country where they're originally from, include an attraction, and they're very proud to see, oh, I went to that place. So we use those information, part of their culture, to incorporate into their activity. A quick example would be, I did like a check for understanding yesterday, so I graded that. And then they have like leveled in boxes, like, I got this, kind of, I really have no idea. So I take note of those, like, I really don't have idea. So today, I kind of like form a small group of those students who don't have idea what's going on. That's one way of grouping, while the rest are doing the regular warm-up. So that's one way to group them as well. If I do a random grouping, I make sure there's an expert in a group, and so I walk around randomly asking a question to a student who I know needs my help, like, can you tell me how you got this? Can you tell? But they don't know that I'm already paying special attention to those students who need help. So that way I know, oh, now he's getting it. How about those students who feel like they're getting less of it? They know I have something on my desk that says for challenge. So if they finish ahead with the work and they think, like, I get this already, I want to challenge myself, then they get that paper also on that desk. Today I gave a homework back to back. One, it says the homework. The other one is homework challenge. So they should do the first page, but if they feel they want to challenge themselves, they can do the other side of it. So trying to cater to the needs of students who need help, advancing those who want challenge. Also, at some point in my lesson, I said, are you ready for challenge? So it's like, let me see if I can do this. So just to get them more excited every day with what they are doing in class. So, and grouping happens a lot of times. So they know, and I always tell them, when I group you, it's for your best. So trust me on this. And I appreciate you doing this. And when I walk around while they do the group work, I always appreciate, I like what I'm hearing. I would like to have commendation for group 3. It's a music to my ears, how you talk about the math. Very good, very good. And like, group 3, good job right there and all that. So tomorrow we're going to do presentation, because today we were talking about SLT 7 cubic functions and the inverse. So I have 8 different problems. I said, raise your hand, group, every group, tell me which one would you like to take care of. We'll do number 1. We'll do number 2. We'll do number 3. So I gave them 10 minutes. And today's Thursday. Number 4, you will be the facilitator of the group. There should be a timekeeper, 10 minutes for this activity. I could hardly stop them after 10 minutes. Like, I know, guys, like, I like what I'm hearing, but then we don't have much time at this point. We need to put some closure to what we're doing. Then we have one. We're very selective with who will present. We don't have to present and everything, but I'm very selective about, like, are you ready to present? I'm giving them heads up. Okay. And then when I do this, I have now from the flip chart the name random name generator, or sometimes this one. I usually pick two. So if I pick, say, Zuli and Marisha, I'll give them a few seconds, talk to each other, who will explain and who will do the work on the board. So if Marisha did the work, then Zuli will explain. My goal is for every student to be able to explain somebody else's work, and if their expertise is on, like, writing and the presenting, then they get to use those strengths that they have in the class. So, like, every day, you get to have a system that works for them, and every month, I usually ask students, like, okay, it's time to evaluate me. What works in the classroom? What does that do? They usually say, you're going too fast, Miss App. Okay, let me know if I need to slow down. At the end of the period, if you think, like, my goal every day is to be able to check every student I have. If I have 120 students, I should be able to check, how are you doing? Are you getting this? Any question and all that? If you think the time was not enough, ask for a lunch pass. I am more than glad to help you. So if you feel you needed my time, but I got too busy because I was working with another group, then ask for a pass. But I tell them, if you get stuck with one question, your friends are your resources, your notes, you have them, refer to them. If you all get stuck, proceed to the next. I'll come around to help you with that. So that's one way. And also, there is always like the feedback that I'm talking about. I tell them, this is your suggestion for me, and I'm doing it right now. So, and this year, one thing I'm doing new is, I don't just tell somebody, like, it has been like the notion, if you talk to somebody outside, you're in trouble, right? So I'm trying to remove that notion by, like, talking to an A student. Can I have a minute with you? Like, okay, how are you doing in class? Just checking in. What else can I do to help you? And what else can I do to help the rest of the class? And I agree, like, you're doing a great job, and I appreciate you. Keep being a leader in class and all that. And then I will call somebody who's, like, struggling in class, like, do you need me to do something to help you? Because I get to read all those, the report card from last year, their communication log. They don't know that I know that they got trouble last year, but, like, they're starting fresh, like, in my class. And I always tell them, you've gone too far. You can do this. We're going to work as a team. It's all right. Don't define yourself with just one test. You failed the test, it's okay. What can we do to improve? So every day is like a positive thing to appreciate these kids, because they're going through a lot outside the class. So I said, I understand your situation, but I want to help you. I want to help you. It's a lot of that encouraging, positive relationship. And every day I get too excited. As a matter of fact, I spent 3 hours, but I don't have to, like, spend a lot of hours, but I love what I'm doing. I do a preview of the topic we're studying instead of just a word wall. We can take a picture of that if you want to. Like, these are the main ideas we're going to talk about for the next 2 weeks. So when a student comes in lunchtime, I use that to reteach a concept. Like, do you remember when you did this? Or to preview, this is what we're about to learn. So something more that could help our students. And it just makes me more excited to teach every day, knowing that these kids would learn so much with the different groups. And they expect groupings, like, oh, I know Miss F will group us again. Like, but now, like, they did well, and we celebrate competitions. They like that. So I tell them, group three, period three is leading with the class average of this. They're going to get a treat from me at the end of the month. I was like, okay, let's try and all that. So it's just so amazing to see these kids progressing, and I share with them individually, like, oh, this is where you were, this is where you are right now. Did you see the progress? It's a lot of checking in with the kids, but it's worth it, I think. It's worth it.
talk to me a little bit about the challenges of floating.
Oh, yeah.
You were saying that one of your classes is not in the room you're in for the others, and that makes it a little more challenging. How do you handle that?
I felt like I'm becoming more dependent with, like, groups of four. So one of my classes, seventh period, is in another room. My four classes are in my, I would say, my home-based room. So when I get to that class, they're in rows, right? Like, okay, let's give it a try. Let's put them in four. Like, it takes me like 2 to 3 minutes. At the end of the class, let's put them back. It's like, oh no, we didn't finish the lesson. Let's try this in rows. And like, it was like, Miss F, I need help. I need help. Like, can you just ask your partner first? Like, he doesn't know too. Like, okay, can you try to put them in groups again? It's just so hard. And like, if a student is struggling, he doesn't get help from somebody next to him, and he didn't do notes, what do you expect? He will start to act up, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's like I speak with the student, all right, now we need to put back in groups. I mean, I need you to work together. I need your help. And like, it's me like trying to communicate to them, like, we have one goal. No one will fail in this class. We gotta help each other. And thank you for those already doing that. Don't be afraid to ask questions, because it's a way of making yourself excellent. Everyone needs help. And then I tell them, look at this word. Do you think this is my handwriting for the homework responses today? No, that's not your handwriting. Do you know who did that? It's part of our team to us, Algebra 2 teachers. We work as a team like you. So I cannot do everything by myself. We need everyone. At some point when they know it's quick check, that's independent. It's like you model a problem for them. Or Algebra 2 curriculum is such a good curriculum. I tell them that it allows them to explore a concept together. And a student told me yesterday, I feel great, I'm getting this. And because they were able to discover, like, look at the function. Can I determine the point of symmetry without even graphing it? Mathematical practice number 7, let's look for pattern structure. Like, like, then they will verify from their group. So it's more of, I would say groups of four is really working well for me. And because they have also the chance to, like, be an expert. I'm the facilitator today. I'm the presenter today. Tomorrow it's your turn. So if a student says, I don't know this, I say, yet. You don't know it yet, but you're going to get there, and we will work as a team. So it's really like working for me to have groups of four, but there will be times that there will be also pair of two, I know that. We can group them according to their, I would say not ability, but to their strengths. When we did a parallel task, where I create like three different tasks, sometimes use triangle, circle, all that, where I intentionally assign a simple task to those who are still struggling, challenging, to those who are really very strong. And then we get to either present, gallery walk, or jigsaw type, where all number one go together, you'll be the expert and share. So depending on the lesson and the time is really a challenge, but you know what, once you get the goal of like this kid setting expectations, you get to do this, you will do this, they will really perform, because like, they know that you're helping them. And I just have a student, like, they started, that 7th period, they started so loud because I have students, you know, there's some students who have 504 and all that. So it's like, I come to, like, be able to, like, be patient with them. They say, we got this, Ms. Ferber, because we respect you. So it's about, really, relationship. Like, you know, I'm working hard for you. I believe you can do this. Ms. F, I can. No, you can do this. You can do this. So we even did a goal setting, like, what grade you want here. They all put A's and B's. And I share it with them. We can do this. We can do this together. And so then I share with them, like, okay, look at their grades. Let's analyze. What can we do? You're getting D and E. Let's set a goal. I should see you extra time. I will be able to help you. Before interim, this should be all A's and B's. The challenge is those students who are working after school, self-supporting. So then I need, like, the counselor. It's a teamwork in the school, too. The counselor, Ms. Sabatino, my resource teacher, she has tons and tons of ideas, like, we can do this, let me help you with this and all that. So I cannot take all the credit for all the good things that are happening. I would say every year, I've been teaching for like 22 years, it's my 23rd. I get more excited every year, and every year I think I'm getting better at helping students because of the teamwork that my Algebra 2 team give me, Ms. Sabatino, the administrator, and of course my students. I'm learning so much from them. You just want to see how they work as a group. Looking at how, without overtaking their thinking, you're going to see different methods, different ways to do with the mathematical practices. I've been telling them, like persevering, right? And solving problems, then different ways. You will be surprised how they think differently, and you encourage them to share that in front. It's just amazing to see how empowered they feel about themselves when they know, oh, I did it differently, and it was correct. And sometimes when they ask a question, I tell them, it doesn't mean that when your group asked me a question that I did not answer a question, that I do not want to help you. No. I'm giving you time to process. What do you think? Let's see. I'm going to come back and tell me what you have thought of this. It's a way of helping you also level up your thinking. I can easily tell you the answer, but that's not teaching. That's telling. It's like a productive struggle. So when you make mistakes, it's all right. It's all right. So when a student comes up on the board, a student like, I disagree because... But he would not feel offended because he knows, like, we appreciate this is a lot you've done already. So we are okay with making mistakes. I don't have any problem with, I have more problems in management when they're not in groups, like the period 7. Because I have to walk a lot and, like, the time is not enough. Miss F, I need this. Come on now, let's work as a team. We got to do this together. So with 8 groups, it's easy for me to manage because as I circulate, I know who's getting it. And then I walk around, and then I know it's getting stuck. Then I will spend a little bit more time, like, can we work together on this? Let's see how I'm going to listen, something like that. So it's a lot of grouping that you can do differently, ability based on. And I did differentiated. I'm just so excited to talk about. I now started doing differentiated homework. If you need more practice on today's lesson, pick this paper. If you need more practice on the lesson yesterday, pick this paper. So they get to choose. And I usually use colored papers for homework. So that's easy for them to find, yeah, I have homework tonight. And I have successes in turning in homework. See? And if a student fails to do a homework, like, what's wrong? Did you have game last night? Trying to be still being, like, not mean to them, but there should be a reason why this student can't do homework. So it's like, can you promise me you're going to do it next time? Yes, Ms. F. Says, I will do it next time. If you need my help, you know where to find me, right? So I set up Remind also, a safe way to communicate with students if they get stuck with the lesson. That Ms. F, I get stuck with number 3. They don't know my phone number. I don't need to know their phone number, but we get to communicate. Okay, let me give you a hint. Something like that. We also have my MCBS classroom. All the lessons notes are put in there, including the sample responses for homework. So they don't have really a reason for not to do homework. But then a good thing I started also this week is like, here are the homework answers. Can you take out your homework? What was the challenging part when you were doing the homework? You say, Miss F, I got confused with that. Oh, okay. So anybody who can give us some pointers on how to do this, then they'll go, just give me one pointer. Just give me 2 this time. And then I do 3, the most 3. We say, like, do you know why phone numbers are like 301-284 groups in 3 or 4 digits? Because you can easily remember 3 to 4 pointers or big ideas, big picture. What do we have to remember for today's lesson? Oh, you need to remember that the HK, that for that HK, I know I have to switch that sign, but K, I'm keeping that sign. Good. What do you have to remember about how do we call the critical point? I should say special point, critical point for square root. Oh, the endpoint. What? How about for cubing, point of symmetry? Do you remember? And try to connect what they know. They feel so great about you connecting their previous lesson. Do you remember your Algebra 1? Let's look back. And then they say, oh, I remember. And I say, your Algebra 1 teacher must be very proud of you. But if they don't remember, I say, I don't care. I don't care if you forgot. I don't care. But as long as you're willing to work with me, we're going to recall it together. You're more matured now. Once you see it again, it will be better. And all that. And so it's like, oh, yes, I remember. Like, today I give them, like, challenge yourself without calculator. Can you tell me the cube root of